I'll dismiss you to the next door meeting. Let's open our Bibles . We read at the beginning of the gathering this morning the Resurrection Sunday story from Matthew. I want to read a single verse from the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 18, as we declare and celebrate the resurrection this morning. Revelation chapter 1, verse 18. The Revelation, the book of Revelations is a very interesting book in many, many ways. I think there's a lot in it that sometimes we read it and we're not sure what exactly everything represents. The single thing that's most important in the book of Revelation is to know that it's about Jesus. It's about Jesus as the conquering king who has all things under his authority and who is going to bring his victory in the end. At the beginning of the book of Revelation, there's this introduction or presentation of Jesus. In chapter 1, verse 18, Jesus himself makes this declaration, "I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death." I have the keys of hell and death. Keys being authority. I have the authority over these things that have been invincible foes up till now. Hell and death, I have authority over them. So Jesus is introduced here as the one who was dead, but now he lives, and he lives not just for a while, but forevermore. Jesus, we declare you the King who lives forever, the one who was dead, who lives, and who lives forever. Lord, I pray that you would minister, Lord, that every heart here today would have a revelation of your majesty, a revelation that results in a response of falling down, grabbing your feet, and worshiping you. Amen. I mentioned, I think, at the beginning of the service that all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, each of them has the account of the resurrection. We looked at the account from the book of Matthew. The resurrection of Jesus was central not only to the telling of Jesus' story, the pinnacle moment, you might say, but it was also central then in the preaching of the early church. When we look through the book of Acts, every gospel presentation in the book of Acts where there's a record of things that were said includes testimony to the resurrection of Jesus. It wasn't a footnote to other spiritual concepts. It was central to the preaching. Peter, when he was preaching in Acts chapter 2, the very first sermon on the day of Pentecost, in verse 32, Acts chapter 2, verse 32, "This Jesus God has raised up, of which we are all witnesses." The very first sermon, Peter's message, he declares the resurrection of Jesus. The next chapter, Acts chapter 3, verses 14 and 15. Peter was preaching to the Jews following the healing miracle of a lame man. He says this, "But you denied the Holy One." He's speaking to the Jewish people who rejected Jesus. "But you denied the Holy One and the just and asked for a murderer, Barabbas, to be granted to you and killed the Prince of Life, whom God raised from the dead, of which we are witnesses." So Acts chapter 2, the resurrection. Acts chapter 3, the resurrection. Acts chapter 4, verse 10. Peter is then preaching to the Jewish leaders. He says, "Let it be known to you all and to all the people," this is Acts 4:10, "all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands here before you whole." In other words, he's saying the man who was healed in chapter 3, he was healed by the power of the name of Jesus, the one who was raised from the dead. So Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 3, Acts chapter 4, Acts chapter 5. Peter is again in chapter 5, verse 30. He's preaching to the Jewish leaders. What does he preach? Among other things, he preaches the resurrection. It's central to the preaching of the early church. Acts chapter 5, verse 30, the God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom you murdered by hanging on a tree. The resurrection was central to their preaching. We skip ahead a few chapters. Acts chapter 10, Peter is preaching to Cornelius, a Gentile. In Acts chapter 10, verses 39 and 40, the apostle Peter is preaching now to a Gentile what is central in his message. And we are witnesses of all things, this is Acts 10:39, and we are witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they killed by hanging on a tree. Him God raised up on the third day and showed him openly. Again, the preaching of the resurrection. Paul is then later on in Acts chapter 13. He's preaching at the synagogue in Antioch. In Acts chapter 13, verses 29 and 30, the gospel is now spreading out. It's touching many, many people. Acts 13, 29, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb, but God raised him from the dead. And you can see other accounts as well. Central in the preaching of the early church was the resurrection. I came to Jesus when I was 19 years old. I want to testify that walking with Jesus has been absolutely amazing. I think that I am one of the most blessed people on the planet. I hope you think that you are too. The blessings of Jesus in my life have just been so numerous, so abundant. I'm not saying there haven't been difficulties, there haven't been trials. There have been some very, very, very deep trials. But the blessing of God in my life in so many ways, culminating with the Holy Spirit and the presence of God, that I can talk to him, that I can walk with him, that I can hear his voice, that I can experience him, that he speaks to me, that he guides me. So many blessings, so many blessings. If I were to say to you, if you were to say to me, why should I come to Christ? I would say to you, there's all kinds of reasons, starting with the forgiveness of sins, getting your resume cleaned up, getting the file of your life, like the sins blotted out, start there. And then the presence of God, the blessing of God on so many levels. But I want you to know, in some ways, the best is yet to come. All the blessings that we experience now, in some ways, are a foretaste. They're a down payment. They are the guarantee that the best is yet to come. You know what it is? It's like going to a fine restaurant. Maybe you've been to a restaurant and you decided to order the appetizers. You decide to spring, go spend the big bucks, and you're actually going to get I don't know what some popular appetizers are these days. There's shrimp, buffalo shrimp things and all kinds of stuff. And you taste the appetizer. And what do you think when you taste that appetizer? This is really good. If the appetizer's this good, I can't wait till the entree arrives. The appetizer in some ways tells you there's something even better on the way. Everything I've experienced walking with Jesus, his grace, his love, his mercy, his presence, the blessings of God in so many, so many ways, wonderful wife, blessed with children, the body of Christ, the family I have, the people I've been able to walk with in the kingdom of God for many years. I mean, it's just absolutely wonderful. But that's just like the appetizer telling me there's much, much more to come. Some of you maybe have taken out mortgages to buy homes. Depending on what mortgage program you were, you bought your home with, you probably had to provide a down payment. Something. And the down payment was your way of saying, banker, Mr. Banker, taste this. And if you can taste this $5,000 or 5% or whatever it is, you can be sure the rest is on the way. Something even greater is coming. The resurrection of Jesus is the guarantee of the greater thing for you and me. If he, the one who has authority over hell and death itself, has beaten that invincible foe, he promises that blessing for you and me. Now, if somebody said to me again, is there value in following Jesus in this lifetime? I'd say, you bet. I mean, there's tremendous blessing. The blessing of God has just overtaken me day by day by day. Again, there's difficulties, but the best is yet to come. As I was considering this last night, as I was preparing for this morning, I was reminded of a visit Darlene and I made to California. Our oldest daughter and her husband, he worked in the tech industry, the internet, you know, industry. And so he was in Silicon Valley for a few years, my son-in-law, Ryan. And I can't remember which company he was working for, doing a lot of work for maybe PayPal or Medallia. Okay, that's right, Medallia. It's an online company. And so we went out there, and it was kind of fun. And he drove me past the Google campus. When you go to Google, there's, you know, the Google emblem is like pretty, it's just, you know it, and all the different colors. And he took me past the Google campus, and there it was, you know, on the lawn, the big letters about yay high Google. And then he started telling me about how great it is to work for Google. He didn't work for Google, but he was kind of like telling me how good it was. And he said, you know, he said, the way they treat their employees is just like epic. He said, Google, you go out there, they have restaurants, cafes, kitchenettes filled with free food for all the employees. They'll even give you free cooking classes right there on the campus. They have on-site physical fitness facilities. You can go use the exercise equipment. In a lot of the places, they have swimming pools, have all kinds of stuff. They have on-site laundromats. They have on-site free haircuts. They have on-site medical staff, so you don't have to take time off from work to go to the doctor. Just go, you know, down the hall, and there you are. You know, all these benefits. Now, those benefits are great. But you know what they have? At the end of the week, you get paid. And they have really good pay. So people don't really work just for the free food and the haircuts. As good as it is, what they work for is the paycheck, that which comes at the end. There's a lot of perks to working at Google, but the real perk comes when you're able to pay your mortgage and your car payment, and you get paid. I'm using that as an illustration. Walking with Jesus is absolutely wonderful. I think the people of God are blessed in ways that it's hard for us to comprehend. But we still face, on this side, tremendous pressure, just like everyone else. Being a Christian does not immunize you from the difficulties and challenges of life. I would say, on the contrary, in some ways, being a Christian allows you to probably feel and experience some of the pains of life almost more deeply. Instead of, in a sense, dulling myself from the difficulties, I face them head on with the power of the Holy Spirit. And so being a Christian doesn't immunize you from those things. It doesn't immunize you from the fact that, well, you get old and you start aching and you realize, you know what, my body's not what it used to be. I said to Chris this morning, I know Chris is struggling. He's got some back things going on. I said, Chris, you've got a new body on order. Walking with Jesus is wonderful, but you got a new body on order. You know, when I'm facing aches and pains, that's what I remind myself of. I've got a new body waiting for me. You know, figuratively. I'm going to experience the resurrection. The victory of Jesus, I'm going to taste that. And that drives the believers. It gives us confidence. It gives us hope. It gives us purpose. It gives us direction. In fact, if you study church history, one of the things you'll find is that saints through the ages went through incredible, incredible difficulties. There are periods of church history where it's pretty overwhelming what Christians went through, not only in terms of just the difficulties of life in general, but the persecution that they faced it. And actually, in other places in the world today, there's tremendous persecution of Christians. You and I live in a really relatively affluent culture and society. I know people sometimes say Northern New York is a little depressed. Maybe it's not as sparkly as other parts of the country, but I'm telling you, we are blessed people up here across the board as a culture, as a community. In other places in the world, Christians are struggling terribly with persecution. Some of you may be familiar with the ministry Voice of the Martyrs. Voice of the Martyrs is a ministry that continues to bring attention to believers of the struggles of believers in different places in order that we might pray and find practical ways, tangible ways to support people. Christians, our brothers and sisters who are struggling. There are terrible struggles. And when you're going through those struggles, whatever they might be, and you might be facing some right now yourself, you might be saying, I'm having a difficulty with my health, I'm having difficulty with my finances, difficulty with relationship, and it might seem so hard, and you might be tempted to say, God, why don't you fix it all now? Why don't you fix it all now? You must know that there is an appointed day coming when Jesus will fix it all. Right now, though, there are difficulties, there are hardships, there are trials. We face them with the power of the Holy Spirit, with the grace of God sustaining us, but nonetheless, we have to walk through them. The resurrection of Jesus fueled the preaching, the lifestyle of the early church. It wasn't simply a doctrine, it was a reality. Of course, many of those in the first century church, at least in the early days, they had actually seen him raised from the dead. Imagine that. They had seen Jesus raised from the dead. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 kind of gives a little bit of a list of people who had seen Jesus raised from the dead, glorified. That's fantastic. We, though we've not seen, yet believe. And Jesus said, blessed are we, a blessed people. So even when we go through hardships, and I know there's some prayers that some of you have been praying and you're like, Lord, I've been praying this one a long time. Would you, could you, why not? There are some things that won't be resolved on this side of glory. But Jesus declared, I am he who lives and was dead. Behold, I'm alive forevermore, and I have the keys of hell and death. And the rest of the book of Revelation is basically the unfolding story of Jesus' victory being extended to all those who put their faith in him, culminating in the last two chapters of the book of Revelation with the New Jerusalem, the holy city, the people of God experiencing the fullness that God has ordained for his people, that he's prepared for us who love him. We're tasting it now by the Spirit. We'll see it in reality when he comes again. Right now, if need be, there's some hardship. There's some struggles. There's some difficulties. There's some challenges. We're looking and we're saying, you know what? We're blessed, but there's some areas. Wow, that's a hard one. That's a difficult one. Jesus, when are you coming back? Jesus gave us a window into this idea of his delay when he shared the parable of the wheat and the tares, the wheat and the weeds. In the Gospel of Matthew, he talked about a field where there was a wheat field. But an enemy came in and planted some weeds in there. And you'd say, well, why don't we just get all the weeds out? That's a good idea. And Jesus said, we can't, because if we pull the weeds, we'll pull the wheat as well. If we pull the tares, the weeds, it'll upset the crop. That'll be the end of the growth season. And in a sense, Jesus is saying there's more growth yet to come. So until the growth is complete, until the numbers of the church are filled, Jesus is delaying his return. And in a sense, we have to live in this world where there's still wheat, there are weeds, there's still tares, there's still difficulties. Imagine for a moment if you go back 1,000 years, 1,200 years, 1,400 years to a time in the church when they're experiencing not only tremendous natural disaster, famine, and all kinds of disease, but they're also experiencing tremendous persecution. Don't you think they were praying, Lord Jesus, come back today. Bring an end to all this. You know, and Jesus, in some ways, he said, I would, but there's more to come in. And he looked ahead 1,000 years or 1,200 years, and he said, you wouldn't know him, but there's this guy, Jonas. There's this woman, Crystal. There's a Rebecca. There's a Jared. I know there's a delay. But until the numbers are complete, there's this delay. And so we live in this season where we're blessed people. We're tasting the blessing of God in the midst of hardship. But Jesus promises, I've got the keys, the authority. I've got the authority over this thing. Trust me. Trust me. Trust me. Trust me. There's a day coming when the trumpet will sound, the dead in Christ will rise, and we will see him as he is. This mortal will put on immortality. The aches and the pains will vanish. The trials, the tribulations will be behind us. We will see him as he is. We will share with him in his glory for all eternity. Hallelujah. That's our God. That's our God. That's our God. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. This chapter is really devoted to the resurrection. I'm going to read a portion of the beginning and then a portion at the end. Chapter 15, starting in verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received and in which you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12. After that he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep. Some have died. After that, he was seen by James, then by all the apostles. Then last of all, he was seen by me also, as by one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. Isn't Paul a great example of how far the grace of God can extend into a person's life? He can touch someone. He can save someone and put him in ministry who was persecuting the church. He says in verse 10, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. I say that a lot. You know, I don't know. I don't claim to be talented. I don't claim any of that. I am what I am by the grace of God. You are what you are by the grace of God. He says, I am what I am by the grace of God. And his grace toward me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. You know, if there had been a night school for apostles back then, Paul would have enrolled, because he was like, I got to give myself to this thing. I got to give myself to following Jesus. I'm going to give my everything. I am what I am by the grace of God, and I labored more than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Therefore, whether it was I or they, we preach, and so you believed. Hallelujah. In other words, people who heard the gospel through Paul as one of the last ones to see Jesus. Then he talks in this chapter about the resurrection. He talks about the victory that we have in Christ. I want you to skip ahead to verse 20. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. First fruits means he's the first one. There's more on the way. Any gardeners here? Oh, yeah, Leanne. I found out about Leanne's garden. She got like this amazing garden. I mean, it's like enormous, you know. And you do some preparation. Maybe you do your seeds indoors. I don't know how all of you garden. You know, you're out there working in April and May and June, and then finally, at somewhere along the way, like your first tomato starts to show. And you know what that first tomato says? It's the first of many. There's more on the way. There's more coming. Jesus is the first fruits. He in his resurrection is the first fruits of those who've fallen asleep. Even if we die, even if these eyes shut in the sleep of death, I can die with absolute confidence that one day these eyes will open and I will see him as he is. He's the first fruits. We are those who follow. Verse 21, for since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. He's going to share a theological truth here. Adam was born, or Adam was created. Adam sinned, and through Adam, death reigned on all. But Jesus came, the righteous one, and in the same way that death reigned through Adam, so it is that all who are in Christ will be raised again in glory. For as in Adam all die, verse 22, even so in Christ all shall be made alive, but each one in his own order. Christ the first fruits, afterwards those who are Christ at his coming. The delay. It's been a long delay. You know, when I came to Christ in 1973, there was a sense of an imminent expectation. Maybe that's a redundancy, sorry. An expectation for the imminent return of Christ. I mean, it was like any day. I mean, we just absolutely expected any day. 1973, I came to Christ. I didn't know if there'd ever be a 1974. I mean, Jesus is coming any day. You know, would there be a 75? In other words, you know, should I just quit school because there's no point in going to college? And, you know, Jesus coming any day. In other words, we really wondered about that. Well, he's delayed. Been a long delay. Jesus, and then at his coming, those who come like him. He's the first fruits. Verse 24, then comes the end when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father, when he puts an end to all rule and all authority and all power. In other words, everything he has authority over, he basically says, enough. That's it. You've had your day, death and hell. Enough. He puts an end to it. Verse 25, for he must reign till he has put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be destroyed is death. Death is a foe. People have tried through the ages to figure out how to deal with the different problems that humanity faces. Medical problems, needs for technology, you name it. People are creative. I mean, I'm amazed at how creative people are. The things people come up with, design solutions to different problems that we face. There's one problem people haven't designed a solution for, and they never will. It's called death. The last enemy that'll get put underfoot is death itself. It's like a foe that's invincible, but Jesus has authority. Verse 27, for he has put all things under his feet. But when he says all things are put under him, it is evident that he who put all things under him is accepted. Now skip ahead to verse 50. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. When Jesus was raised, he was raised incorruptible. In fact, the disciples were with him, and they didn't even necessarily recognize him. There was a different composition to his body. You get sown in one form, you come up a different form. You get sown corruptible, you get raised incorruptible. You get sown mortal, you get raised immortal. I was talking about gardening before. You sow seeds, seeds don't come up. You know, you don't just get a bigger seed. I mean, there's seeds in the plants, but if you plant a seed, you don't expect 2 months later to just get a giant seed. It comes up looking different. And he gives that principle here. Nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Verse 51, but behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your sting? Ha! Rhetorical question. You don't have one anymore. Oh, Hades, where is your victory? It's a rhetorical question. You lost your power. There's one who's risen, and he stands and he holds the keys of hell and death. Verse 56, the sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And then he closes with this exhortation. Therefore, Bible study rule is, whenever you see a therefore, find out what it's there for. Why does he say therefore? He says, in light of this, in light of the victory of Christ and the promise to all who follow him that they will share in that victory, in light of that, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. There may be hardship. There may be difficulty. There may be some things you're thinking, I would love to see the Lord do on this side of glory. You're going to see some victories. I'm telling you, God's going to do great things. But all of that is it's a down payment. It's a foretaste of the greater thing to come. The early church understood the resurrection as central to the gospel itself. Whenever they preached the resurrection. When they preached to those from a Jewish background, they preached the resurrection. When they preached to the Gentile nations, they preached the resurrection. Sometimes it was received, sometimes it was rejected. In fact, in Acts chapter 17, when the Apostle Paul in Athens shared the message of the resurrection, it says some believed, but others laughed at him. They thought it was a foolish message. He preached the message because it's central. And it's central to us today. The book of Revelation, from which we read the first verse, verse 18, is a letter to comfort the saints during the delay. That's really what it is. There's a delay. It's been 2,000-year delay now. You know, when you read the letters in the early church, clearly you get the sense that they expected Jesus to come back in their lifetime. In fact, when some of the members of the early church died, there was a question, will they share in the resurrection when Jesus comes? That's why 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, some of you know that passage, the Apostle Paul speaks a word of comfort and says, no. When Jesus comes back, those who are alive will be transformed, but those who are dead will actually be raised first. So it comforted them. But there's been this delay, and in the delay, there's sometimes hardship. There's difficulties, there's challenges. But the book of Revelation was written to comfort. And Jesus is introduced right at the beginning. I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Take good note of this. I have the keys of hell and death. I've got the victory. That declaration isn't reserved to the end of the book. It comes right at the beginning. So you know right from chapter 1 who this is that we're approaching. This is Jesus, the one who died and lives again. He lives forevermore, and he has all authority. Then you read the next, you know, it's 22 chapters long, the book of Revelation, and there's all kinds of things going on. Some of you have read it, and there's dragons, there's beasts, there's all kinds of things, and sometimes we don't understand it, but we can tell, boy, there's tough things going on. There's some difficulty going on. You might be wondering, well, what does that represent, and what does that represent, what does that represent? The big picture, a season of delay where there's tumult. There's difficulty, there's challenges, but in the end, Jesus comes, and he brings his victory with him and the promise of eternal life to those who come to him is realized as Jesus transforms these lowly bodies into heavenly bodies, his resurrection victory. I want to say there's a lot of reasons to come to Jesus. There's a lot of reasons to serve him with all your heart. He's going to bless you, yeah, in this lifetime. But there'll be difficulties. The greatest blessing is when your eyes open and you'll see him face to face. Nothing like that. Would you pray with me right now? Lord, I thank you. I thank you that there's clarity. There's clarity in this doctrine of the resurrection. There's clarity in the narrative of the resurrection. There's clarity in the response of the apostles and the early church to this message of the resurrection. It is crystal clear, central to the preaching of the gospel. And Lord, today I pray that it would be central in each of our lives. I thank you for everything the resurrection of Jesus means to us. The proof of who he is, the demonstration of his authority. Lord, I thank you today. Lord, I pray for the spirit of comfort. Faith to see miracles, faith to see all kinds of great things. But I also pray today for the spirit of comfort. Lord, where we maybe have gotten discouraged, seems like a long delay. Some prayers just aren't getting answered. I pray, oh God, that be faith, that be a confidence, that the resurrection victory and the promise of eternity with you would sustain us. Sustain us as we experience the challenges of life, diminishing health, disappointments, persecution, the difficulties of natural disasters and who knows what comes upon us. I pray that we'd be a shout of joy in the camp because Jesus, the one who was dead, is alive and lives forevermore. Father, I pray for that. Father, today I ask you to touch every heart here. If you're here today and you've never opened your heart to Christ, can I say that's really where this really takes shape? Until you receive this message in your heart in a very active way and say, Jesus, I receive you. I I see you as Lord. Forgive my sins. And take me into your fold. Until you do that, it's a message, it's a story. You might even think it's a true story. But there needs to be a response. The Bible says we need to receive him. And as many as received him, to those he gave the power to become the children of God. If you've never opened your heart to Christ, I want to encourage you today. Would you do that? Actively move from a position of saying, I've heard this story, I think it's true, to the place where you say, and because it's true, Jesus, would you forgive me? Jesus, would you cleanse me? And Jesus, would you put my name in your book of life? That's really what it means to become a Christian. It's a response. It's not just that you know something, but it's a response to the something you know. From there, Jesus will take you on a most amazing journey. He'll guide you. He'll teach you. You'll walk with him. He'll help you through your struggles. He'll pour out blessings. He'll sustain you in difficulties. But he'll take you on a most amazing journey, one that culminates in that day when the trumpet sounds and your eyes open and you behold him in glory. And lo and behold, you're transformed as well. But it begins with a response to something you've come to know is true. Jesus is the King. He's the one who lives and was dead, the one who's alive forevermore, the one who has authority over hell and the grave. If you've never opened your heart to Christ, can I urge you to do that right now? In the privacy of your own heart, maybe you can come afterwards and talk to me. I'd love to know what God was doing in your heart during this service. But can I urge you to invite Christ into your life and begin that most amazing journey with him? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God, you're faithful. God, you're faithful. Lord, I do pray for some who've grown weary. There's a weariness. Would you buoy up? Buoy up the saints. Revive. Put fresh air. Fresh vigor in each one as they walk with you. Sustain them in the journey. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Steve?
In Romans chapter 10, starting with verse 8, but what does it, the righteousness of faith, say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Verse 10 says, for with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So this last declaration is really a confession. He is Lord. He's risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Let's stand to our feet, and let's let our faith say what it really wants to say right now. He is Lord. I believe that you rose from the dead. He is Lord. And then we're going to say, you're my Lord. It gives you a chance to make your good confession from the heart. And then we'll sing, he is our Lord. He is is Lord. He is Lord. He has risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bless you all. Happy Easter.
Amen. He is risen indeed. God bless you. Enjoy the day. Celebrate together.